when I was young, you called my name. I tried to run, but still you came. And you stepped into the dark, 'cause that's just the kind of God you are. When heaven seems beyond my reach, you still see eternity in me. You're turning ashes into art, 'cause that's just the kind of God you are. It's in the empty tomb, it's on the rugged cross. Your death-defying love is written in your scars. You'll never quit on me, you'll always hold my heart, 'cause that's the kind of God you are. You gave me freedom from my sin. You told me I could start again. All the hurt is dead and gone. Now we're your daughters and your sons. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. We once were lost, but now we're found. Forever you hold us in your arms, 'cause that's just the kind of God you are. It's in the empty tomb, it's on the rugged cross. Your death-defying love is written in your scars. You'll never quit on me, you'll always hold my heart, 'cause that's the kind of God you are. You are holy, holy, holy. I tried to run, but still you came. And you stepped into the dark, 'cause that's just the kind of God you are.
Thank you. Good evening. Praise God. Well, we're glad you're here tonight. Hallelujah. We always talk about that, but pleasant to be planted in the house of the Lord, that you'll bear fruit in old age, be fresh and flourishing, to declare that the Lord is upright. And upright means that he is faithful, he can be dependable, he's reliable, God's true to his word. That's good. And we're glad you're here. First time guests, we're glad to meet you this evening. And if you have a prayer request, we want to put those in. We want to believe that God will answer our prayer according to 1 John 5:14-15. He will. Don't forget Friday, we have a power in the word at 11 a.m., at 10 a.m., and at 11 a.m. we have revival prayer. And then we're having, don't we want to pray for good weather this Saturday? Easter egg hunt, good weather between 1 and 3, the ages of 2 and 11. We're going to have an Easter egg for the kids. That is a great thing. March 29th is Good Friday. It's a crosswalk, 11:45. I tell you what, you need to come and walk up to the streets of Elwood City with us. I tell you, it's a great thing. We're going to meet at the Yellow Caboose at 11:45. That is a wonderful thing. And then that night, Friday evening, that evening, we're having service here at 6 o'clock. We're going to have communion. It'll be good. Revival prayers is coming on April the 6th. At 6:30, Woody Woodson is speaking, and at 7 o'clock on Sunday. And so invite some friends and come on out. It'll be a good time. And don't forget, we have these revival. You pass these out. That's a good thing to do. Yeah. And do we need anybody to pass some of these out? Let's get a couple of them. Here, he's right behind you. He'll take it. All right. There you go. All right. That's good. And here we go. Oh. Yeah, we can. Father, we're going to enjoy your presence tonight. Thank you that you're always with us. Thank you, Father, that you never forsake us, never give up on us, Father. You never remove, you always accept us, Father. And we thank you for loving us. And we're going to give you praise tonight and thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Amen. Thank you. Let's all stand this morning or this evening. Praise me the weapon that conquers all anxiety.
is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what heaven looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what heaven looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. We cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lifted high. All creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, 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 we praise you. Oh,
a glimpse of your glory tonight. You can do exceedingly abundantly above what we could even ask or think, Lord, because you're more than enough. love you, Lord. You are faithful, Lord.
Yeah, we thank you, Father. Even when it looks like we're not winning, we are, because we come from a place of victory. So we thank you, Father. We fight from a place of victory to victory, and we tell fear and doubt to get out in Jesus' name. We take you off, and we were created to abide in Christ, and that's where we dwell. Our dwelling is in Christ. Thank you, Father, for the treasure of serving you.
Out of the way.
make yourself known to us tonight in a greater way, Lord. We want to walk with you. We draw near to you, Lord. We spend this time with you. You are the good shepherd.
Thank you. That is the heart of the Father in harvest. Transforming lives, getting people saved, getting their minds renewed, making them soldiers for Jesus. That's the heart of the Father, the harvest. He says the harvest truly is plenteous. The fields are white already to harvest. Thank you for it, Father. Lord, as that song just said, pour out your mercy on the hearts of people, Father. Fill every heart with your mercy. Thank you, Lord, and your grace. Oh, yes, Father. Thank you. Your love. Thank you, my Father. Glory to God. Let's take a moment and pray for Jim Witter's little girl, Lizzie. Went to Children's Hospital today with strep throat. And they're going to have to do some procedure on her. So, Father, we lift Lizzie before you in Jesus' name. We ask you to touch her, Lord, and cause the surgeons and nurses and technicians and staff and everyone to do a wonderful job, Father, a fine job, a successful job, and whatever they're going to do to help her in that situation, Lord, to alleviate the discomfort, the infection, in Jesus' name. And Father, we ask you to minister to Jim right now in Jesus' name. Help him, Father, and to be strong and to trust in you right now, Lord. We thank you. Fill his heart with your mercy in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Kay Biddle's mom went home to be with the Lord. Her name is Dory. She's been to the church a number of times. And what a sweetheart she is. Pentecostal lady through and through. And she is with Jesus now, walking the streets of glory. And so, Kay, is that tomorrow night, the viewing or whatever? Friday's the viewing. Okay. And the funeral, both on Friday. That's up in Grove City, right? Knox, PA. Okay. All right. So be praying for the family, and praise God. Father, we do thank you. We have this assurance, Lord. You said that we can know that we have eternal life. He's written these things that we might know that we have eternal life. We don't have to guess about it, Father, or know, or hesitate for one moment, Lord. Hope that we're going to heaven? No, we can know beyond a shadow of a doubt. Thank you for that wonderful assurance, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. You can be seated. I was talking to an astronomer today. The guy's a PhD in astronomy, and he was telling us about this eclipse that's going to take place on September the 8th, you know, where the moon's going to move in front of the sun. And I think in this area, it's going to be like 97% blocked. You can go up to Erie or to Cleveland someplace and see the full thing. But you have to wear special glasses because you're not supposed to look right at the sun, right? Because it's so bright. So I was thinking about the New Jerusalem and Jesus ruling in the New Jerusalem. And the Bible says that he's going to be the light in that city. There's not going to be any need for electricity or light bulbs. He's going to be the light. And we're going to need some light. We're going to need some glasses probably to shade our eyes to that light. It's going to be so, so bright. I'm telling you, when you get into the presence of Jesus, he has such a bright light. He is the light of the world, and in him is no darkness. So we thank God for Jesus. And I'm so grateful, too. My wife went to talk to her surgeon yesterday, and she viewed the latest MRI, which we did about a week ago. And she says that everything looks great. Evidently, that fluid is draining perfectly. And so I'm grateful, and she's grateful. So let's thank God for that in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Glory. And when I mentioned to you, too, that last Sunday, we took up an offering for the food over there in Kenya for the children in that orphanage. And $1,750 we were able to send to that orphanage in Kenya. Once again, 1,750. It was just a little bit below that, but we rounded it up. So that's what got put in the mail there on Sunday. Monday we put that in the mail. Whether Sunday or Monday, anyhow, it's in the mail. Hallelujah! Glory to God! Thank God. Jesus went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil. So you and I are doing the same thing, going about doing good right here in the house of God. Well, let's go ahead and give tonight. Ready to receive from him. Thank God for a spring harvest. Believe in with me for a spring harvest. I just even like to see 100 souls. If we get 100, we'll boost it up from there. All right? But don't forget that Easter egg hunt, and that's a great way to get some children in the kingdom right there. Amen. If you're free on Good Friday for that crosswalk, we're going to pass out tracts as we're walking the streets of Elwood City, so be sure to come out for that too and fulfill our Operation Saturation, which we're going to try to saturate this area, this locale, with the Word of God. Amen. Well, let's go ahead and pray tonight, and I believe Brother James is coming around here to pray for him. No, somebody else? I don't know. Somebody going to pray? Well, I'll pray then. Heavenly Father, thank you so much. Lord, as we present our tithes and offerings to you tonight, Father, we thank you that the liberal soul shall be made fat. And you said in Proverbs 19:17 that when you give to the poor, you're lending to the Lord, and the Lord will repay. So, Father, thank you tonight. Cause that seed that we've sown, Father, to be multiplied exponentially and to be used in a way that's going to save lives and draw people to your kingdom, Father. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Glory. You alone, Lord, are the only one that can. We thank you, Father. Glory to God. We've been talking about events preceding and including the passion of Jesus, what he went through at this Easter time. And, you know, it's exciting to know what his heart is like. And, you know, as you observe these events, it really does show you Jesus' heart. And we want to know what the heart of God is, because he's the one that we imitate, right? And so we're going to take a look at that tonight. And so, Pastor Gail, come on up here and share a few minutes with us. And Father, thank you for your word tonight. We ask you to illuminate it in our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. Well, I was been meditating about some of those things about what Pastor is sharing, and I believe Jesus is our example. And I'm going to run my little clock here so that I know I'm doing exactly five minutes. I think it's important you know that Jesus. The first thing I see of Jesus is that he was obedient. And when I think about that, Jesus lived a life of complete obedience to his Father, complete obedience. In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 7, it says, "Behold, I have come to do your will, O God." And I think that's one of the things we need to remember. We want to do the will of the Father. He focused on the Father's will. One of the things he said, that the world may know that I love the Father and he gave me commandment. Even so, I do. I like that. He was obedient. I do not speak on my own words, I speak the words of my Father. And the reason that is because he spent some time with God, spent some time in prayer. He humbled himself for becoming obedient to the point of death. I mean, he really set aside himself. He was all man, he was all God. And I'm telling you, he had an opportunity to sin, but he never sinned. He never made a mistake, never. And he loved the Father. And the reason is because he trusted him. And when you trust God, I think this way, the T is you turn to God. That's the key. You turn to God, and the R is you rely upon him. The U in there is you walk uprightly. Don't be concerned what somebody else is doing. What are you doing? And then I like that's the S is you submit. You surrender. God, what do you want me to do? Where do you want me to go? What do you want me to say? And the last T is you thank him. Hallelujah. So I believe God was very obedient. Jesus was obedient. He trusted him. He was thankful. That's the second thing. First of all, he was obedient. He was obedient. And the second one, he was thankful. He was thankful. And John 11:44, when Lazarus was raised from the dead, you know, he comes over and he comes up and says, remove the stone, take it away. Now, wait a minute. Martha says, he stinks. He's been dead for 4 days. Jesus said, He just said, you know, I am the resurrection. But here's what Jesus said in John 11:41. Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I thank you. He thanked him before Lazarus came out. So I believe it's in having a thankful attitude. This is a personal opinion. I believe you can be thankful even when you don't feel like it. I believe you can be thankful when you don't feel like being thankful. I think you can be nice even if you don't feel nice. I really believe he was very thankful. The Father, I thank you that you've heard me. How about when he read the 5,000? He did 5,000 and the 4,000. He thanked God before he broke the bread. Yeah. And he would have more than enough. 5,000 people is a lot of people to feed. That's right. But he believed before he gave out the bread. He believed before it came to pass. And I believe that's part of, believe means to be firmly and fully persuaded. Firmly and fully persuaded what? That God will answer my prayer. Yeah. But my body doesn't speak, my mind, my finest. No, I believe he's done that. Yeah. I think the other thing we talked about, that God has supplied the needs, but the important is that it's so that was at 1 John 5:14. This is the confidence. You ask anything according to his word, he hears you. Yeah. I'm telling you, you put your, and when you have confidence, that means you have an act. You have an assurance and a confidence and a thankfulness that God's going to do what he said he'll do. Hebrews, I believe it's Hebrews 6:18. God, it's impossible for God to lie. I like that. But the Lord was really good. And then the third thing, the first thing, he was obedient. Second, he is thankful. And the third is that he was a servant. And a servant attitude, the attitude is much more important than sometimes the action. You know, because, you know, if you do it out of the wrong attitude, it's worth wood, hay, and stubble. Isn't that what it is? So you want to make sure you have a good attitude. Lord, help me have a good attitude to do this. Help me have a right attitude, Jesus. And he will. In 10:45, "For the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom." I truly believe that when Jesus came, and he prayed, "Not my will, but thy will be done." That's what he said. And his servants are not self-seeking. They're not looking for attention. You're going to do it with the right heart attitude. That's vital. Philippians 2:8 is really good. It's let each of us look out not for only for our own interests, but for the interests of others. Let each of us look out not only for our own interests, but for the interests of others. Let the mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Let this mind be in you, which what? You have the right attitude in serving. Jesus humbled himself to the point of death. I really believe that he wants us to do the likewise. I think he wants to have an attitude of compassion and humility, that he would do that. I believe that's important. So you're going to do obedient, and the second, you're going to be thankful, and the third is be a servant. And that's really the key. What can you do to bless somebody else? What can I do to bless somebody else? That's a key. I think that's very key. And that's good. We're good. Bob Galino's up. Do you want me to leave my clock here so you can do it for 5 minutes?
Yes, I need your clock. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hallelujah. We're going to look at Psalm 22 tonight. I think it's descriptive of what Christ went through. So if y'all can turn there. If we can put Psalm 22 up, please. It says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Psalm 22 was wrote by David, and David was going through a tough time. I'm not sure what. But I would guess it would probably be King Saul coming after him. And he was in troubled times. He was distressed. But to think about David doing that, this was a prophecy that was going to come true 1,000 years later with Jesus on the cross.
Right.
Isn't that something?
Amazing.
That's awesome. So, and he says, why are you so far away when I've groan for help? Hallelujah. 1,000 years later. Well, here's the answer in Psalms 22:24. He hasn't despised nor abhorred the affliction of the afflicted. Neither has he hid his face from him, but he hears him. He hears you. When you're in pain and in affliction, when you're crying out, God hears you. Yes. You may not think he's there, but he hears us.
Amen.
He's faithful. His mercy and kindness endureth forever. He hears us. Habakkuk 1:13 says, God cannot look upon sin. He can't look upon sin. He's holy. He's righteous. He's pure. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I want to take a look at what I really was... wanted to look at was about stripes, Jesus' stripes. I wanted to share that with you tonight. And we can go to 2 Corinthians 11:24. I'm moving fast. I only have so much time, so we're going to move fast here. So 2 Corinthians 11:24, this is what Paul says. Paul says, 5 times I received lashes from the Jews, less one. The Romans had no such law, scourging, on Matthew 27:26. Sorry to move fast on you. Again, I apologize. The Romans had no such law for scourging. Was a punishment ordered for Jesus by Pontius Pilate. But he did get 39 lashes.
Yes,
40 was for a convict, prisoner, whoever they were, but Jesus did not.
Right.
I wanted to talk to you about the Romans used what they call a flagellum. And sailors use a cat of nine tails, so you see the difference. But the flagellum was three straps, and at the end of the strap, they had pieces of lead. And the flagellum, whenever they whipped Jesus, it actually left a stripe, but the lead went into the skin. And when they pulled that whip back, it ripped the skin. And that's that was very important to me to share with you, because 39 lashes coming on your body, and they whipped him from his shoulders to his feet. One writing said that his beard, the skin, had been pulled away. And then I thought, well, you know, when we pray for somebody, or you pray for yourself, you say, by his stripes you are healed. That is true. But I want to read to you Isaiah 53:5. Could you put that up, please? He was wounded for our transgressions. Wounded. He had wounds. That meant that his skin was ripped off his body. It just wasn't a stripe. The skin was ripped right off his body. He was bruised for our iniquities. Our iniquities, our weaknesses, our aged sicknesses. He was wounded for those. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. Now let me read something to you real quick about a flagellum. It's a short whip made three or more leather straps. It connected to a handle with a lead tip tips. The lead tips were actually had like little jaggy edges sticking out. They weren't round and smooth. They were made to rip the skin. And it said that the flagellum comes the word fillet. So you can know where I'm going with this. If you know what a fillet is, a flay, it's actually a strip of boneless meat. It's sliced meat. That's what he looked like. And which is descriptive of what this weapon would do to a human body. So that's why I wanted to read Psalm 22, because I felt I didn't know enough about praying and just saying, by his stripes you're healed. No, it's a lot more of that, as we just read. 1 Peter 2:24 says, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on a tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. We were healed 2,000 years ago. So he was wounded, bruised, chastised. He had stripes for our healing. And I wanted to, I kind of admitted this, but Jesus, I watched a movie on this, and Jesus was tied around a column, and they chained him around a column. Now, the Romans, or the Jews, I don't know how that went, but they would put you on a post this high and chain you down. But Jesus was on a column, and actually this column had marks on it from the whip, could even see. So he went through a lot for us, church. It just wasn't an easy thing for him either. It was pain. So my heart went out for him. I think my time's up. I'm not sure. But there is, I wanted to share a couple more things here. I don't know the time. I'm sorry. Who's talking to me? Okay. You come up, sir. You're next.
That's good stuff, brother.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Go for it, sir.
You want to come?
Thank you.
Okay, Pastor asked me to share in Luke 22, starting in verse 47, where Judas betrayed Jesus. And, you know, betrayal, that's, most of us have had a little bit of betrayal in our lives, and we've experienced some of it, but Jesus had the ultimate betrayal. And I was reading out of the Passion Translation, said, no sooner than he finished speaking when suddenly a mob approached, and in front of the mob was his disciple Judas. He walked up close to Jesus and greeted him with a kiss, for he had agreed to give the religious leaders a sign saying, the one I kiss is the one to seize. Jesus looked at him with sorrow and said, a kiss, Judas? Are you really going to betray the Son of Man with a kiss? When the other disciples understood what was happening, they asked, Lord, shall we fight them with our swords? Then one of the disciples swung his sword at the high priest's servant and slashed off his right ear. And Jesus stopped the incident from escalating any further by saying, enough of this. Then he touched the right side of the injured man's head, and the ear grew back. He was healed. And Jesus turned to those to seize him, the ruling priests, the officers of the temple, police, and the religious leaders, and said, am I a criminal that you come to capture with clubs and swords? Wasn't I with you day after day teaching in the courts? You could have seized me at any time, but in the darkness of the night, now have you come to find your time, for it belongs to you and to the Prince of Darkness. And when you think about this, you know, Judas, when he began following Jesus, you know, like a lot of the disciples, they didn't know what to expect. They were expecting this kingdom, this different type of kingdom, where they had financial rewards. They were expecting a lot more. And, you know, even when Jesus said, you know, at the table, you know, one of you here is going to betray me. And they all said, is it me? Is it me? And no, Jesus knew who was appointed to the betrayal. And when you look at what happened, you know, what he had to do to bring about this, just the mob that was out there. I was reading about this a little bit last night, and, you know, there was probably 1,000 people there. Oh, yeah. Because it said he gathered the Sanhedrins, he gathered up all these people. And, you know, they were prepared because Barnabas had just been, he'd been captured for insurrection. They knew it was a Passover. They had, you know, they had a army ready to break down any revolution because Jesus was, you know, I mean, the Jews didn't have an army. They had to count on the Romans to do it. Yeah. And, you know, the Roman soldiers, there was Roman soldiers, there was the Jewish ones had clubs and the Romans had swords, right? Uh-huh. Yeah. And that's what they came in. When you can imagine, there was a mob of, you know, 1,000 people. Uh-huh. And how they turned it, you know, against him. And, you know, we come to where one of the disciples swung his sword. Yep. And I think in another gospel it said it was Peter, you know. Uh-huh. He swung his sword and cut off a servant's ear, right? And what did Jesus say? He said, no, the kingdom of God is not won with the sword. That's right. You live with the sword, you're going to die by the sword. Mm-hmm. He said, we don't win the kingdom of God with a sword. Right. And then what did he do? They say that was probably the first occasion of healing an open wound. Uh-huh. In the Bible when his ear grew back.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, that was probably the first occasion he was healed. And, you know, one of the things we look at is that, you know, how how he was betrayed, and you know, like I said, they didn't want any trouble, and you know, they said, well, how he mesmerized the crowd, and you know, that's what they came with, lanterns, torches, and the temple police, they had clubs, and it was a massive vigilante crowd that came after him. And of course, Jesus committed no crimes against Jews, against Rome, or Caesar. He committed no crimes. It was an injustice, and it was a mindless mob. And he approached, and you know, when Judas came to betray Jesus, I mean, this was in the dark, right? He kissed him and he embraced him, because he couldn't make a mistake. So, you know, we just look at this. That was probably the most ugly act of treachery at that time. And, you know, that's one thing is Jesus knew all the details ahead. And, you know, what did Jesus do? He called him a fellow. He says, "You are a fellow." And he said, "Do what you came for." And when you look at, you know, Judas, he was in that place at that time. If he didn't do it, it wouldn't have happened. And, you know, that's hard. You know, we can despise Judas, but he was not, somebody had to do it. Somebody had to betray Jesus. And, you know, so, and, you know, there's a lot to unpack here, but I just want to say that, you know, we have to say, you know, who are we? We can betray Jesus. Yeah. You know, we have to say, you know, he said there was three things. He said, it can be fatal. You put your sword, he told Peter to put his sword back in. All those that take up the sword must die by the sword. And we can be foolish because Jesus, he could have called. He said, do you think he could have called 10,000 angels, right? And, you know, one angel killed, what, 185,000 people in the Old Testament? So. And then number three is fulfillment. It must happen that way. He said, put your sword away. And that was a thing. And then we have to look and say, who are we? Are we the rejecting crowd, the resisting soldiers, the false disciples, the hypocrites, or are we the disciples, weak and struggling, but still following Jesus? And that's what, you know, that was what Jesus, he stood so, triumphant as he went to the cross.
Amen. Praise God. Yeah. Pastor Matt, come on up a minute. You know, isn't it interesting that the crowd that cheered Jesus on Palm Sunday was the same crowd later that said, crucify him. It shows how fickle people are. Come on up. I think you had some information or some revelation on these garments or whatever you want.
Yeah, so we were just doing some studying, all of us are doing some studying on the crucifixion. And when you fast forward a little bit to when he was actually on the cross and the soldiers, they say usually four soldiers were involved in the crucifixion to do one person's crucifixion. And they divided his garments. In John 19, it talks about when the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they divided his garments into four parts, one for each soldier. So that kind of says four parts, one for each soldier. Do the math, four soldiers. I know, that's brilliant. But with the tunic remaining, the tunic, I looked it up, it's kind of like a T-shirt, a long T-shirt. you wear it next to your skin, whereas a cloak is more like a coat. So when you think about maybe the parts that they divided, it might be like a belt, sandals, maybe a headdress, maybe a cloak. But what was left was the tunic. And the cool thing about the tunic is it was seamless. So all of our shirts have seams. All of our coats have seams. But this was woven from the main part of the shirt all the way through the arms as one piece, which is kind of neat. It was high valued back then. So they didn't want to, so they cast lots for that, which was actually a prophetic thing. If you look at Psalms 22, Bob mentioned Psalms 22. But if you look at Psalms 22:18, it says, they divide my garments among themselves, and they throw dice for my clothing. Yeah. So that's pretty cool that the psalmist David prophesied this from a download from heaven, yeah, and foretold how his garments would be divided. Yeah. And so we kind of see that maybe the other, I already talked about that, but oh yeah, the last thought I had was, so this one piece, this tunic is one piece. The only other piece of material or clothing in the Bible that was one piece was the high priest's garment. So that kind of points to he was our high priest. And that's not a coincidence. So many things point to, the Old Testament really does point to Jesus.
Well, let's stand tonight. Well, this Sunday we get to celebrate Jesus' triumphal entry coming into Jerusalem to be the Passover lamb. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, I think it's verse 7, says he is our Passover. He is our Paschal lamb. He is the ultimate sacrifice, and his blood consummated a new covenant, consummated the plan of redemption. So we're going to have some palms. We're going to pick those up at a flower shop. So we'll have some palms to wave on Sunday morning. But Palm Sunday, wonderful time of celebration. Yes, he was headed to the cross, but he was also headed to do something spectacular for humanity, right? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your goodness and what you've accomplished in his life. And Lord, you said, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Father, we want to do that. We want to let our minds be the same as what was in Jesus. Help us to do that, Father. I'm going to repeat that again. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Father, who humbled himself, saw himself as no reputation, and humbled himself to the cross. So, Lord, help us. We don't have to go to a cross, but we can take up our cross and die daily and have the same mind that Jesus has. Thank you for it, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. See you Sunday morning, and we'll rejoice.
Turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through.